So back again for a Saturday night ghost story, and I'm very excited to have a special guest on my tour, one that I have always wanted to have on my tour, but never could quite get around to it. My tours last about 90 minutes, so it's difficult to have this guest for that long, but introducing for the first time to any tour group that I've ever had, my dog Tinkerbell. Tinkerbell. Say hey. Hey. There you go. Now, I just want everybody to know that I did not name this dog. My wife named the dog Tinkerbell, but she is my overly anthropomorphized partner in crime. And we've got a couple of minutes. Wait and see who jumps on. But tonight we're going to be talking about Charleston as a living, breathing city. So this is something I've always believed to be true. I struggle with the concept. To tell you the truth, it's something I've always tried to put into words. This short video might end up being me rambling, but we'll see what happens. So, hey Jennifer, Chris from Edinburgh, nice to see you, buddy. Chris is a steady guest on our videos, and we love having you. And the rest of you guys that watch, we're just so grateful that that you guys are out there, watching our videos and enjoying them, hopefully. And please feel free to comment on this tour and see if I'm making any sense to you, or if there's something that that maybe you have an idea of. I think that Charleston itself has been anthropomorphized. Of course, it's something that we do as human beings. We try and make objects more human, so that we care more for them. We can love them, and that's certainly the case with Charleston and my dog Tinkerbell. So let me turn this around, because we're walking down Church Street, one of the most beautiful streets in the city of Charleston. Let's see if I can do that for you. There we go. So I think when people talk about Charleston, a lot of times they'll talk about Charleston as a human being, as a usually a gentle belle, a beautiful woman who's kind and sweet and picture perfect, beautiful. And certainly there's every indication here, that she is, all of that. But if you've given tours in Charleston, you come to know her a little differently. She certainly is beautiful. She certainly is gentle. But there is a darker side. Now, this is a ghost story, and I promise we'll get around to that in a little bit. It's more of a supernatural musing anyway. But let me just... There we go. Let me just read to you a quote I found from a fellow named James Caskey in his book, Charleston Ghosts. And I think that this, I don't know if I agree with the whole thing, but I think it anthropomorphizes Charleston in a different way. He says, many people, after spending a long weekend being stealthily seduced by this grand dame of the South, mistakenly think that they have gotten to know her. They believe in error that after a long stroll amongst the rustling palmettos and gas lamps, a couple of sumptuous meals and a tour or two, that they have discovered everything there is to know about this seemingly genteel, elegant city. But like any great seductress, Charleston presents a careful veneer of half-truths and outright fabrications, and it lets you, the intended conquest, fill in many of the blanks. Seduction, after all, is not true love, nor is it a gentle act. She whispers stories spun from sugar about pirates and patriots and rebels, about plantations and traditions and manners, and yes, even ghosts. But the entire time, she is guarded about the real story. few tourists ever hear the truth, because at the dark heart of Charleston is a winding tale of violence, tragedy, and most of all, sin. So that's quite the passage. Charleston is all of that as well. And I think we can compartmentalize the two Charlestons, the beautiful, picturesque city in the daytime. But the darker part of Charleston is also part of it as well. So there's another poem that I'll read a little later on. I've actually memorized most of it toward the end of the tour. But, you know, when this concept of Charleston as a living, breathing city has always fascinated me, because I think that, you know, apart from anthropomorphizing Charleston, Charleston is a being of its own, a supernatural being. The most of the bricks in the city were made by hand, baptized in the sweat of the brow of the men who made them at Boone Hall Plantation, the Holbrook Brickyard. Even so far as you can see in some of these bricks, fingerprints, the thumbs of the craftsmen. And further imbued with physical essence by the bloodied hands of the contractors, the laborers, and the enslaved. Carried forth their DNA into the future so that we can almost feel their presence here. Perhaps the soul of Charleston is this physical essence. But there's a spiritual essence carried in every one of these bricks as well. The spiritual essence of the laborer, the craftsman, the songs they sang to keep a rhythm to make their work more efficient. You can almost hear in Charleston's silences the clinking of the mason's hammer as these bricks, each one of them, were tapped into place. Indeed, Charleston is, to my mind, alive like that. Now, there's another aspect. If Charleston is alive, if Charleston is a living, breathing city, then why has she let her citizens suffer so? I mean, Charleston has seen war, disease, hunger, death, destruction. 5 major fires prior to the 20th century that destroyed much of Charleston. You had an earthquake that damaged 90% of these buildings here. A war on our soil twice, enemy occupation both times. And this city has survived. How y'all doing tonight? Good. So why would a living creature let her children suffer so? Well, the truth of it is, so after each one of these disasters, the people of Charleston came together as one, unified, equal in their efforts, their singular purpose of restoring and rebuilding. More recently, a confused person wandered into a church on Calhoun Street, 2015 in June, murdered 9 good people. Now, that is a tragedy of unbelievable proportions, but the unity that Charleston showed after that tragedy was unparalleled anywhere. Protesters couldn't get a foothold here because the people of Charleston, Charleston's children, were unified in their resolve to make sure that something like that never happens again and will always be remembered. When we talk about, you know, history here in Charleston as well, I think that, you know, the history that we convey to you is important for you to know, But is Charleston just a stage on which all that history takes place, or is it an active participant? Anyway, this is me rambling on about how I believe that this city breathes and is alive. Now, there's a poem by DeBose Hayward. Sorry, Tinkerbell was squirming. So DeBose Hayward wrote Porgy and Bess. And it is a really fun opera, if you haven't seen it. But he says, "You who have known my city for a day, and have heard the music of her steepled bells, and laughed and passed upon your vagrant way, caring only what the city tells to those who listen solely with their ears. You know St. Matthew's swinging harmonies, and have heard old St. Michael's tales of golden years, far less like bells than chanted memories. But there is something wanting in the song of lyric youth with voice unschooled by pain, and breathing stillnesses that throng dim corners, only stirring again when bells are dumb. Not even bronze that beats our hearts throb back can tell of old defeats. But you who would know this city for your own, come with me into the night." Here we go. All right, Ting. "You who would know this city for your own, come with me when the night grows deep and kind, down narrow ways of troubled stone, and floods the wide savannas of the mind with tides that cool the fever of the day. Into the dark, companioned by stars, we'll seek St. Philip's nebulous and gray, holding its throbbing beacon to the bars, her prison spirit vibrant in the stone, knowing her empire of forgotten things. Then will the city know you for her own, and see you meet and share her sufferings, while down a swirl of poignant memories, herself shall know you in her sufferings." So, what I try to impress upon people is that there's so much more to Charleston. And if you would know this city for your own, she demands, rather inspires, a fealty from her visitors, a respect for what's come before. She inspires loyalty. And she is beautiful, but dark. If you neglect Charleston, if you come here seeking only the pleasures of the flesh, let's say, if you come here without regard to what's come before, Charleston will visit you where you're staying and bring upon you some of the darkest visions in your nightmares. She'll show you the conflagrations, the twisted, limb-torn bodies strewn in the street during war, the fevered, blackened, yellow fever victims, all of the things that Charleston has seen over the years put together in one terrifying image can emotionally shut down an individual. And you don't want that. If you're kind, if you respect the city, and if you enjoy her, she will bring the most beautiful visions in your dreams. You'll see some of the most spectacular vistas. She will seduce you. So, I hope you enjoyed that. it was a little rambling, I know. But you know, if you have any suggestions, if you feel this way yourself, if there's something that has been drawing you to Charleston and you don't know what it is, perhaps it is the fact that Charleston has seduced you, that Charleston is alive and it's calling to you. Tinkerbell. Tinkerbell, what do you think of that? Anyway, Tad Legree, wishing everybody out there all the best. Thank you so much for tuning in again and you know, enjoying these videos with us. You know, we're we have to do this. We can't not do this. This is our tribute to Charleston. This is our way to love this city. Thanks, and have a great night, guys.